ended of what happened?
Well, it's similar. I mean, basically, we did see a bit of different things with the patch. So I'm excited to see how trends kind of continue today. Junglers in general have proven to be even much more powerful, I think, is one of the bigger lessons we have learned with the patch. So, in fact, we already see here both teams getting a jungler. But real quick, the initial bans, it was Midas, Tremble, Parasite, and Warbeast taken out. We have Moira into Moraxis and Ophelia into Tempest, of course, and then there's Revenant even coming out for X-Sync over here. But what do you think about the draft so here, far here, Kat?
I think the banning phase in the beginning is pretty standard. I mean, Warbeast obviously good in Kazu's hands, as well as Tremble. So, I mean, complexity focusing a bit more towards Kazu rather than any other player in there, which is understandable. Kazu is very good. Both teams are, though, picking up a lot of initiation heroes here pretty early. Moira with the long-range illusion thing, and Moraxis with the PK, as well as the Tempest. So, a lot of initiation so far.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting about X-Sync especially. We actually obviously simply put the elephant in the room. I mean, it's pretty clear. They are kind of, we don't know exactly what's going to be happening after this cycle, but it almost feels like things are starting to fall apart to an extent. Obviously, Keizu did officially announce he is 100% leaving Heroes of New Earth after today, in fact. So definitely a little bit of a sadness there, a player that's been around for a long time, but course is what it is, and obviously wish them the best of luck. And as far as other players go, again, nothing has been necessarily 100% official, but not exactly sure. Not exactly sure how things are going to play out. So simply put, yesterday against Fresh, we saw them. They picked some strange things, and it didn't work out, to say the least. And the second game, though, they actually stepped it up with their draft, and things they lost it in the end, sure, but it was a lot more back to normal. But my point is, I guess we're going back to here again. There is still good money on the line, and here they are drafting actually a pretty sound lineup, something you would expect to see from them. So that is good to see. Behemoth is now going to be their fourth pick coming out here. I'm guessing probably more of a suicide, but we'll see what that ends up being actually. So, but yeah, what do you think about the Behemoth pick here?
Yeah, I think Behemoth is pretty good. Obviously, it's a bit not as strong as in TMM where you can pick up Merrick's Bounty, but I mean, it's still a very strong like initiator, counter initiator, especially versus that Tempest. It's going to be really easy early on to cancel those Tempest holds from far away. So, I mean, but the one pick I've never seen Sync play Revenant. That's the only thing standing out to me. All the other heroes I've seen them play, so.
Yeah. Well, how about that final pick? Mage Vayne coming out. This is a hero, obviously, of many that actually got some changes in the patch, and he actually got a couple of buffs here. What do you think of a Mage Vayne and how he stands now?
I think he's pretty good versus the new patch is like only good versus like intelligence heroes. Versus strength heroes, it might actually be worse because now it's a percentage-based mana drain, and versus strength heroes, they have like a low mana pool already. So I mean, with what I've tested, sometimes it drains even less than, you know, before patch because it's a percentage base now.
Yeah, no, that's a really good point, actually. Never really thought about it that way. But I guess to be fair, I mean, that's always at the same time been his idea, he's supposed to be strength, is that against intelligence, against mana pool in general, he's great against because obviously he increases his damage output and ultimately sets up a big ultimate. So, but that is a very interesting point you bring up there about against strength heroes. Moraxis is the final pick here. So how do you think it's going to match up against this Hellborn team ultimately?
It depends. I am wondering how they're going to see it. Mikkei is going to play the Revenant, so I'm assuming, because they might man up Trilane, having Behemoth in the mid lane and just Mage Vayne solo short, because they should know that complexity is running a suicide, like a full suicide. So I don't think they're going to be manning up with the heroes they have. I mean, they might dual lane with Prisoner or Luna, but I don't think so. So I think they're going to man up with Revenant, Moira, and Ophelia in the offensive jungle. That's what I think.
Okay. All right, we'll see if how they decide to line it up right here now. Okay, so I was told that, I guess, X-Sync, they were going to need a pause at the beginning of the game for about 5 minutes or so. So we are setting up for a little bit longer of a pause here, but We got a couple more things to talk about at least. So, but I want to reiterate, Zephyr was banned. Zephyr was gentleman's ban, as they're calling it. It's same thing yesterday. So they decided to gentleman ban agree. He's a hero that's obviously been getting a lot of interest in this patch, and it's been kind of fun. It seems like the overall census is, and everyone really kind of does agree, that the hero maybe is just a little too strong here right now. I mean, do you agree with that sentiment, Calamine?
I think the hero is definitely strong, but I think personally it's almost the same as before, just that now he has an easier time going into the jungle in the beginning. And the problematic thing with that is that you have a Zephyr, which is obviously strong, and another like short lane farmer, which is going to be priority farm as well. So, I mean, having two like hard carries running at you, it's kind of problematic. But if people would choose to run Zephyr in the short lane still as a priority farmer and have something like a Parasite in the jungle, I don't think it's going to be the same. It's just that when you run it as a jungle, it becomes a bit more problematic. Yeah. But I definitely think Zephyr is strong.
Yeah, he's definitely been getting a lot of attention on the TMM scene and been the popular one. In fact, I'm actually curious, too, as far as I know his win percentage has kind of been shooting up here on the hero playlist. Yeah. And he's, what is he at now? 63%. Yeah, pretty good, pretty good. I know that, I mean, obviously, I believe there are some nerfs in the in the works, at least, to do more sooner than later here. So, but yeah, I mean, it's interesting when I look at it. It's a lot of it for me is that Zephyr as a hero just has not been seen in forever. Like, he's not really been relevant in TMM or competitive scene, of course. And it's just kind of now that he's relevant again, he got these buffs, so it brought the interest to definitely try him again. And obviously, I think that's part of it, where people almost like forgot how to play against a Zephyr. And the obvious answer is, you know, things like Mystic Vestment and, of course, a Shrunken Head. Now, I know that every hero's not going to be getting that, and earlier on in the game, that's where he really shines, and you're not necessarily going to have the Shrunken Heads. But a little bit of me is like, I think there maybe is a little overreaction to an extent, but I do agree ultimately that it should be toned down at least a bit here. Yep. So when it comes to that's definitely a fair point you bring up, though, about the lane. I mean, as far as his laning goes, it seems like he's not really too crazy by any means.
No, he's pretty much the same as before if you run him as that short laner, but
yeah,
I agree with you.
Yep, so we'll see. We'll see what changes happen to that. This patch as a whole, again, it was a big patch here, Kat. I mean, is there anything that, what really stood out to you about it? What was more the thing that you were looking forward to?
Something I looked forward to. Let's see. I'm always a fan of Mage Bane. It's kind of my favorite carry, so I like seeing changes on Mage Bane. So
just so happens to see him here.
Yeah, exactly. I was just gonna say that. So I'm kind of excited to see this high tier matchup right here.
Yeah.
See how he's gonna be played and how the mana combustion changes gonna be played out here.
I mean, you look at this Hellborn team, actually. Again, it's not a lot of intelligence focus. Of course, Luna, technically, I guess Tempest too, but as far as being anti-intelligence, you know, it's not like it's a Dr. Repulsor carry here or anything like that. It's not that matchup idea. In fact, it's a Mage Man versus Dark Lady, which is obviously, that's a classic matchup, really. We've seen that many times in the past, a long time ago. So, you brought up about how it's not just, it's almost like a nerf against strength heroes, and here we do see a Prisoner and a Moraxis, and I mean Dark Lady as well. She's not necessarily going to have the biggest and most mana herself, so yeah, the mana combustion change, this game specifically, it might actually be a little bit more of a nerf than an actual outright buff that he got here, which is kind of interesting.
Yeah,
but
that's what I think.
Have to deal with that. Anything else about the patch, though? I mean, there's a lot of changes.
There is a lot of changes, but I don't know. Let's see. Let me just go through. I like the Defiler changes. Granting 4 extra strength in the beginning and the ulti change. I mean, she's just a lot better early game right now.
That Staff of the Master is fun.
Oh yeah, I tried that. That's so much damage, actually.
it's pretty ridiculous. I've only done it in mid wars, but I mean, I've heard people suggest that if you're pushing racks fairly early on the game, you happen to have a staff, you can actually take out the racks, both racks, in a matter of like a double click of it, essentially, in like 10 seconds. So, I mean, me personally, I think that's fine because that's her niche, right? Like that's what she's supposed to be, a huge pusher in the end.
Yeah,
so
I totally agree. She's not that tanky, depending on what you build also. I mean, she should be fairly easy to take down if it's not like super late game where you have six items. But if you like, if she's pushing early game, it should still be like relatively easy to kill. It's not like it's a strength hero with helm. You know, if you go helm, she's still a ranged hero. So I don't know.
Yeah.
I think it's fine.
Yeah, no, I've always respected the hero, especially with the huge AoE silence that she brings to the table. But I mean, at the same time, yeah, she's just not a competitively viable hero, and I do understand why. But hey, the very rare occasions we have seen her, it's fun, and you know, maybe the changes to her in this patch will at least bring more interest once again to start seeing her. But all right, we are back, no cat. So finally, could actually see some Han here now. And how it's going to play out. So the lanes that you're talking about are the possibilities. It looks like it is going to be a little more traditional in the end. They are sending Behemoth Suicide here.
Yeah, okay. I mean, that's definitely more safe, a safe way to play, because if you did decide to like man up Trialing, and if something goes wrong, you're just going to lose on so much more. So, I mean, it could have worked out, but it's like a high-risk, high-reward kind of scenario there, right there. Mm-hmm.
You see, is Moraxis going to end up bottom? Yeah, probably. Okay, yeah. So there's going to be some Moraxis with Oscar here. Fantastic against Moira. It seems like we see this matchup a lot more than not. I mean, Moraxis not typically a suicide hero, but I feel like it's just because of how often we see Moira that's pretty much made him a suicide hero with this W.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, that's also a reason why I thought they would man up Trialing, because Hellborn kind of has... Like, you know that Moraxis is going to go suicide. There's no way they're going to prisoner or Dark Lady suicide. So when you have a Moira, I just felt like they could manned up. But I don't know. Choosing the safe route. But I don't know how well Moira's going to do, because Moraxis can always use the Arcane Shield no matter what. I mean, Moira needs level 2 with that Mana Sunder to be able to deal with that. So
yeah.
Early on, I think Moraxis is going to have a fairly good time.
And, of course, Moira, her Q in general, the Shards of Harkon definitely got nerfed here in this recent patch. So a couple things adding up that may not necessarily be able to have the greatest time against Moraxis. But off the bat, you're just going to put in some auto attacks. Not much Moraxis can do about that, to be fair, as he kind of has to accept it and run away.
He didn't buy a shield, though, to be fair. He just got it in the side shop there. He was saving up some gold, so now he should be a bit more tanky and should be able to manage some experience here. I think these two heroes are pretty weak in the beginning, so
yeah, Mage Bane not really going to be able to provide the most in terms of assistance here, so that is definitely crucial to know. But I mean, even with the shield, again, Insane is doing a pretty good job, it seems like, of making a point of that top lane. Similar story, Behemoth also having a pretty difficult time, as you would expect, going up against the Dark Lady and the Aluna here. Aluna, of course, in the hands of Love, man. This guy, I feel like that's all he plays here for complexity, is the Aluna support. But he does it well. He plays it well.
Yeah,
so.
Definitely. He's going to rotate mid here as well. Might be trying to set up a kill here.
Bottom lane? No, she's going to be...
No, mid.
Yeah, middle lane.
Aluna's almost dying.
Oh my god, Aluna's actually in trouble. You see Revenant's chasing him back with that Defile. Not going to be enough damage in the end. It's going to turn his attention on a prisoner. In fact, trying to run away now as realizing he's getting low. The shackle's up. He went for the invis, but of course the shackle allows to see through it. And Bloodlust kill for Fuzzy Sloth to end it off there. That's, well, good play from Complexity.
Yeah, well, that was kind of greedy by Mickey, though, not going to lie.
Yeah.
He was really wanting that Aluna kill after seeing the possibility. He was really low, though, to be fair. You kind of got there late with your camera, I think. But Aluna was down to like less than 100 health at one point there. Popped the health potion, and then you came in with the camera. So.
Yeah, that's well. But that's the important thing about that matchup, though, as we saw there. The shackle, of course, being very powerful against Revenant, how he sees through the Infis. So, the Essence Shroud of Revenant, unfortunately, not really doing a whole lot for him right there. So, Obviously, yeah. Big kill for Complexity, definitely. And what could have been a Bloodlust for Mickey instead is a Bloodlust for Complexity on Mickey.
Yeah, course, you definitely don't want to give Fuzzy Sloth on Prisoner a good start. He's been playing amazing with this hero lately. So.
Yeah. He definitely has been. You know, speaking of this matchup, I would assume that Revenant ideally should be able to have a pretty good time, right, against Prisoner. But you do see Aluna obviously rotating over now, the kill that Prisoner got. It's pretty good for Complexity here. But on paper, you would say Revenant probably should have a good time?
Yeah, I think Prisoner can't really do much. He can just sit back and throw a hatchet every now and then for the creep kills and then get some levels. And then he just has to sit and wait for rotations. And you see Aluna, this is the second time she's been here. So that's good for Complexity, I would say. I'd say they're playing this correctly. But you do give up the top lane, though, where Behemoth is going to get a lot of experience now when you choose to have the Aluna mid.
Yeah. So. Meanwhile, bottom lane, actually Moraxis does get picked off. He caught that pretty much halfway through. He's just trying to run away, but simply couldn't. Obviously, the blink of Magebane allows him to catch up and close the gap pretty easily and eventually set up the kill. I didn't really catch how that started, but obviously, somehow wasn't able to use the Arcane Shield effectively enough against the Moira.
Ophelia wasn't there, so I don't see how that can happen. Because he should be able to Arcane Shield off the stun. Did Magebane, drain all of his mana or something?
It might have been that. I honestly am not sure. I caught it, halfway through, so.
Yeah.
He was
Otherwise,
not able
I can't
to.
See that happening. Ophelia gonna take the DD from the bottom rune right there. So, good rune control coming out from Slapped, as he tends to do when he's playing jungle.
Yeah. No, X-Sync especially, I mean, they are on top of rune control. I feel like they're the most recognizable team to do that. It always seems like that they make sure to get that rune, and it sets up so many kills for them earlier on in the game. You know, if it happens to be in Haste or an Invis specifically, could do some work with it. Top lane, that's going to be a kill. Yep, Dark Blades from Dark Lady, a little too much damage. The Power Throw on top, and that is a lot of incoming damage for Behemoth.
Yeah. When Dark Lady can pretty much kill any suicide when she gets those Ghost Marchers really early on into the game, so it's always scary to lane against the Dark Lady at this point. So, but he goes down right there, and that's unfortunate, but hey.
Yeah. You got Dark Lady now nearly 400 gold per minute as a result of that kill as well. You do see the creep farm, 39. You compare that to Magebane, 31 and 11. So both carries obviously doing a very good start here. And pretty expected, though. I mean, again, going up against a melee suicide on either side, especially and with that babysit support. So both. Now, of the two carries, again, this is a matchup that you think back to early on days, and we definitely saw it quite a bit. But nowadays, I mean, which is scarier, you think? The Dark Lady or the Magebane getting free farm here?
Early on, I would definitely say Dark Lady. And Dark Lady will remain the scarier carry throughout, all the game until you hit the point where it's, 50 minutes plus. Then I think Magebane takes over the scariness.
Is it because of the blinks, the mobility, you think?
The blinks, the mobility, the item builds. I mean, Dark Lady does not build the same items as Magebane. Magebane tend to not go Shrunken Head, while Dark Lady does. So that's just giving up on a damage item where Magebane will build something extra, like a Wingbow or a Heart for the extra health. So, I mean, at some point, just because of the item builds, I think Magebane gets a bit scarier.
All right. Well, speaking of Magebane, again, he's the carry that we don't see too often. We know what Dark Lady's going to go with the Rune Cleaver first, but should we expect a Rune Cleaver on Magebane as well? Or actually top that, or middle lane, excuse me. Revenant going to be pulling an Elemental Void, gets the kill. Moira Illusion obviously dies, but that all worked out for Complexity once again. I'm pretty sure that's Prisoner started that off, and then Tempest was there to follow with the ultimate. Bottom lane, Moraxis. Uh-oh, he's being dove. Not much room to go there. The mana drain just too much in the end. And Ophelia, that time, was assisting and, in fact, got credit for the kill. And it's now going to push the tower. So, kill on either side happening. Probably a little bit better for Complexity, though, with the middle kill.
Yeah, it depends if they're going to get the bottom tower now. If they're going to get the bottom tower off this Moraxis kill, I would say that favors X-Sync. But, yeah, if it looks like they're going to get it. So I would say, all in all, they're going to come out on top of that exchange.
Yeah. Right there, you see Magebane skyrockets quite a bit. Now, Darkly, she nearly dead at the top lane, by the way. Revenant, he used that death to actually TP top and try to set up a kill, but just coming up short. Behemoth was not level 6 yet. If he was level 6, I'm pretty sure that's a definite kill with the Shockwave, but wasn't able to be level 6 yet, so thus Darkly was able to charging strikes away and survive. But again, going back to Magebane here, Rune Cleaver or maybe something else, you think?
I think Kazer is more of the guy that will build a Helm before Rune Cleaver. He tends to always build Helm before he goes farming items. So, I mean, he might go Rune Cleaver, but I don't know. Maybe we'll see Helm as well and see them pushing together as five with the Ophelia and everything like that. Mm-hmm. So we're just going to wait and see.
Yeah, we'll see what Casey does. There we go with that life tube. So, again, it's nothing certain yet. That could be either one at this point, so we'll see. Prisoner was using the illusion that he had to try to bait something out here in the middle lane, but I think Mickey wasn't really having any of it. He picked up on that pretty quickly, so not a big deal there. But you do see, again, the matchup here, especially with now two kills happening. Prisoner dominating against Revenant. Actually, top lane, Behemoth, he needs to be a little careful right here. Aluna's coming in with a flank, going to put the Ward of Sight down and then fall back perhaps, but...
Ooh. Worth to note as well is Behemoth is maxing out his heavyweight over the Fisher. Oh, they're going to go, though.
There we go. Jumping in. Dark Blades are up, and, well, shortly after, kill happens. So, he mentioned the build that he's going for. Well, it doesn't really do a whole lot there when he's silenced the whole time anyway, so not much you can do about that.
But this build is just, like, saying that he's confident that he's going to get a fairly early portal key because it's... if you don't like max out heavyweight like very early on, it's like hard to max it out later because I don't know, you kind of need the stun when you have the PK because PK does not really do anything unless you have a lot of points into heavyweight because you're like it's only for the damage in that sense. But I don't know, I think this build is fine if he can get some farm, but it doesn't look like it the way it's been going so far. Yeah. I think it's going to be around 20 minutes or so. It's PK timing, so I don't know. Maybe yes, some more levels by then.
Yeah, I think it's safe to say right now, especially, he'll probably rotate to the jungle here, try to maybe farm some camp. That's where the heavyweight definitely can come into play for sure. Into that jungle, being able to use the Enrage for a good amount of AoE damage constantly in the jungle here. So, looks like, speaking of the other jungler, I mean, both junglers really, Ophelia, you know, about 250 gold per minute. Again, we talked about this yesterday, I had Squeery on, actually, and we were talking about these jungle changes and how, overall, it's definitely a buff for a lot of these jungle heroes, but there's a couple where these changes to the jungle maybe not necessarily as impactful, and I think Parasite is the obvious one, and then Ophelia is kind of another one where it's she's not necessarily going to really benefit from these changes compared to, like, a Tempest or these other junglers here. So, I mean, do you agree with that, or...?
I think the jungle is just a bit easier now to play. I think overall it will have an effect on the GPM, but, I mean, people before the patch still managed to kill camps outside with Tempest and Ophelia. I mean... It just makes it a lot less tedious to play in the jungle now. Like some camps just randomly goes back in there and, oh, you just lost 50 GPM because the hard camp decided to go back into the camp. Now you don't need to worry about that anymore. So I think right now we are going to see a lot more consistent GPM versus actually raising the GPM. That's what I think.
All right, yeah, no. Definitely makes sense there. I mean, speaking again, higher GPM, you see Tempest, 370 gold per minute here, so... He happens to be doing much better than Ophelia this time around. Of course, he does have two assists, where Ophelia does have a kill, to be fair, and he got an assist for that bottom tower push. So, really, I guess both of them do have a tower push in the end, as obviously top one was just pushed in. Yeah. But yeah, Tempest is quite a bit ahead is the point here. I mean, is that surprising to you, or do you expect Tempest to be this far ahead?
No, I don't think it's surprising. Tempest, untouched, should stay above 300 GPM every single game. Regardless of spawns, and with that tower kill, obviously bumped him up a bit. So I think this is to be expected, especially by a player like what you got. He's amazing in the jungle. So
yeah, he's very comfortable with that role, most certainly. You know, I see some people bringing up, and we got to stress this because It's not a combo we see often, but it's one where you may think, oh, that's crazy powerful. Moira and Mage Bane. So Moira's Mana Sunder, it may not work as you may think of initially, guys. It doesn't actually, when you Mana Sunder, Mage Bane Ultimate doesn't actually take effect of the having zero mana. It actually just, it makes it to where it was before, essentially. So it's basically not an OP combination that you may think initially with the Mana Void of... or Mana Rift, even, of Mage Bane there. So again, to kind of clarify that before, I see some people bringing that up here, but that would be insanely strong if that was the case. Yeah. And I think we would have seen this combo a lot more if that actually worked, but doesn't work that way, so. Okay, looks like Tempest is back, though. Could resume here soon. Man, Revenant, Mickey, they need to get him going, though. Revenant's definitely one of these heroes that, especially in a farming role, you really want to be very active with him early on with the Invis, so.
He's had a very rough start, and it's going to be hard to recover on a hero like Revenant. He doesn't really farm that fast. Of course, he has the modification, but I don't know. It's not enough, in my opinion. He needs to snowball through hero kills, and at this point, I don't see where they're going to get them. They would have to group up as several people and pick people off and just snowball or get him back in the game through that. So
yeah.
But as far as solo killing heroes, I don't see him killing anyone except for Aluna, maybe. So if Aluna just plays with his teammates standing next to someone all the time, I think Revenant's going to have a hard time coming back into the game. He's farming 270 gold per minute, though. I expected him to be a bit less. So that's good.
Yeah, he has something here at least. And that level 4 mortification, you know, a good synergy with that behemoth especially. And maybe he can move around and set up some kills that way. That could be an idea. But at the same time, behemoth, I'm sure, going to try to maybe farm that jungle as we're talking about, try to get that portal key sooner than later. So, yeah, definitely some space here for Complexity to get some good farm themselves and maybe make some plays happen as well. We know the carries are expect what the carries may go, but Tempest is always an interesting hero, I feel like, as far as item progression. He actually chose to go the Astrolabe here first, so not even a Ring of Sorcery. He actually went the Blood Chalice instead of the Ring of Sorcery. So more of a greedy self mana build there himself, but obviously what you got likes that here. Portal Key next, or... you like the shrunken head here, or what?
I think Portal Key is a bit greedy, seeing as I mentioned in the draft, you have a behemoth, obviously going to sit back, and he's always probably going to be ready with a Fissure. So I think going Portal Key will be a bit greedy here in the beginning, but he also might do that, and just because he can always wait for the Fissure to happen before he goes in. So, I mean, there's a lot of counterplays and mind games, but... I think he might go straight into Shrunken Head, maybe, and a couple of Striders, or a pair of Striders, not a couple, that would be silly.
Might not be the most efficient idea there, So, yeah. All right, we'll see what you guys decide to go for here. So, you know, fortunately, we've had a couple of pauses here now to start this game, so losing our momentum, but hopefully that's the last of them, as it looks like they are now ready. And going to be good to go here. So, again, guys, this is game number one of our first best of 3 Euro Losers Bracket Finals. The winner of this will move on to play Fresh, who's waiting around. I'm sure even possibly watching the series here, seeing who they're going to match up against. But this happens to be also a rematch of the Cycle 1 Grand Finals, of course, where Complexity came out on top, 2-1 in that series. So
they're going to go mid here, though. Invis Behemoth.
That's a big start. The Shockwave open. Now, the Mortification wasn't up initially, but it doesn't even matter. I mean, Defile goes out, and they had too much of a trap on him. So well played right there to set up the kill. And that's, that's Revenant getting involved, just as we're talking about.
Yep, indeed.
Middle tower push now, but their secondary top is being pushed, but I don't think fast enough, though.
No, that's going really slow. I don't think that's going to happen. If Sync decides to defend, I don't think it's going to happen, because they do have a lot of time. I think they have their glyph up as well. So I think they have time, I mean.
They don't have the most TPs, though, I will say that. Behemoth and Mage Bane are the only one with TPs currently, but they actually are going to fall back as Complexity, so... I don't think they actually might have been able to defend that because of the lack of homecoming stones. But, you know, Complexity maybe not 100% aware of that, of course, and decides to play it very safe here.
We do see the helm on Magebane, though, as I was talking about. Kaisu seems to like to do that. He's just that kind of player.
Yep. I know that's going to be a controversial pick. I always feel like, you know, helm especially, just especially on a carry, it does seem a little odd. But, you know, you made a great point that Kaisu just is that kind of player, and sure enough does it here. Tempest, he gets found, by the way, in the jungle as four players collapse onto him. Basically, you know, more illusion even there. So... And this is definitely the makeup that Sync has, though. It's really that 4-1 lineup where they got the four roaming supports, in a sense, and then they got the one hard carry that's going to sit back and try to farm, and eventually take over the game. So they're accomplishing that right now quite a bit here.
Oh, they lost the mid tower, though. There was no one pushing and no one defending, so that's unfortunate. We do see Revenant up to 350 GPM again, so he's recovered through a few hero kills, as I said, and also the mid tower there. They did group up, as I mentioned. So,
yeah,
I think they're gonna keep that up because there's no reason to be sitting back and farming. They do have the mage bin, but I don't know. Since he went helm, I don't think they should be farming anymore.
You know, mage bin. It's interesting here because he just bought a broadsword. Now, what I think he may actually look to split up the helm and use the life tube towards a rune cleaver eventually. So this is maybe like a temporary item for the time being, and then it transitions into a rune cleaver. And I don't know if that's 100% going to happen, but he just bought a broadsword there, so I almost feel like that's going to be the case. But anyways, Magebane, by the way, he's been gone. You see that helm though coming into play. Ophelia's touch also helping here, and it more than it keeps him alive. I mean, didn't even get to half life really. Right there, so.
Thanks to the helm. If he didn't have the helm, he would for sure die there. So that's where you see the item paying off.
Yeah.
But I think he might actually do what you said. Depending on how the game goes, of course. If they're feeling like they have a lot of free time at the point where you can afford it, I think they will. He will actually do that. But
yeah,
we'll see.
You know, I feel like it's been a while since we've seen this idea of a strategy, this whole 4-1 idea, where it's, again, just the hard carry and then the other four just move around constantly and set up kills and basically play two different games. But it's working out so well for X-Sync right now. I mean, the roam is constantly catching Complexity here throughout. I mean, the Hellborn jungle right now is basically controlled by the Legion team this whole time. Cover of Darkness used right there on just Ophelia. He thought a lot more was coming for sure as, oh, did my Skype just crash? I think it's Skype just crashed. 1 second. Oh, that was me. Yeah, that was me. My Skype crashed. 1 sec. My bad. God, I swear to God, Skype lately has been crap. Man. I can't be the only one that's been having so many Skype issues. Anyways, give me a second here, guys. Gonna recall him. I'll be good to go. Once it opens back up. There we go. Gonna call here. Okay. Oh, and then Mickey times out. Good timing. Huh. All right, welcome back. Yeah, that was that was me. My Skype has been having some issues.
It's all good.
But we're back here. We're back just in time for a pause.
All right.
Yeah. All right, so, but yeah, no, this very active strategy here of X-Sync is definitely paying off big time. I mean, Complexity seems like they're not able to do a lot against this. It's constantly catching them in their own jungle even, so.
Yeah, we do see a portal key right now on Meraxxus, so I think he just got that, and he's walking towards this jungle, so I think that might be a turning point here for Complexity.
Ooh, yeah. Definitely. Could be a big chance for them to make a play because, again, that is the downside of this strategy, of course. If they do get a little too greedy and all of a sudden run into all five of the other team, and they're basically fighting, you know, outnumbered, of course, or Magebane is simply just sitting back and farming here. So that could be the where it backfires onto them. So they're definitely a pretty tense situation coming up right here.
Yeah, prisoners smoked up, so that's going to be good for them. We'll see how it plays out, though, because they do have the Arcane Vortex. Moira is kind of sitting in the back lines here. So if anyone gets gone on, it should be set up for a really easy arcane vortex. So
yeah,
that usually causes a lot of issues.
All right. Well, as soon as Mr. Insania is back, we'll be good to go. Speaking of that Moira there. But yeah, the portal keys, not only on the prisoners, you pointed out, but the Moraxis just getting in. Definitely an opportunity here to catch them big time. You see the Striders, by the way, on Tempest, so he didn't eventually get that into the Mystic Vestment even. So going with more of a combat early build here, being able to withstand.
It's understandable versus these Legion heroes that he wants a Vestment.
So. Yeah. Yeah, I'm looking forward to a big mana rift, man. That's always a fun ability to look out for in the fights. And I know it got buffed, right? The radius of it, I believe.
Yeah, just a buffed. Bit by 25 or something.
Yeah. So I guess nothing too crazy here, but all right, we'll return here.
It can make a difference.
Yeah. Oh boy, here we go, prisoner. That's going to be a big prison break to start it off. It's going to connect with a couple. Looks like pulls him into the arcane vortex. That was weird. Moraxis, meanwhile, he's going to follow it up with a big jump as well as the Matrix comes out. The shockwave going to be used. It's not going to matter. The element of it only catches Moira. So really not the greatest right there, actually, as Ophelia is running away. Revenant's just sitting in the middle in the meantime.
They killed all of his creeps, though, except one. So that's really painful for him.
Well, he got something successful out of it in the end, and the two kills plus the Ophelia creep kills, at least. Well, they get all three, actually. Well, maybe not. The Skeleton King giving them a little bit of troubles right here, and it looks like that's actually going to barely survive. But no, actually, the second one did as well. So, actually, he ends up with two of the three in the end. But still, the hero kill is obviously pretty important there for complexity.
Yeah. I mean, Miraxis with that PK showing off. Immediately when he got it. I think he got it before that fight. I mean, he has red boots, so I don't see him having any other items. So, yeah, that definitely proves to be the difference maker there, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Mage Pin's going to actually steal the Hellborn Ancients here.
Ooh, now again, he doesn't have the Rune Cleaver yet, so he's pretty slow at this, honestly. He's getting a couple of the Crushers killed right here, at least only the one, but I think it's going to eventually have to fall back. Yeah, you just see how slow he is, man, without that Rune Cleaver.
Yeah.
Jeez.
He's going to split up into the Cleaver now, though. He's trying.
If he can manage it, yeah. It's a tough task here. There we go. Okay. There we go. Yes. So, yeah, he has the other components. And yeah, so that's an interesting idea. It's, you know, it sets you up. Makes you a little bit. Anyway, as we saw in the middle lane, you pointed that out. If he didn't have that, then he very likely may have died there. So.
Yep. I agree. But I wonder what he's going to use the B-start for. If he's just going to save it for late game where Mage Bans usually go hearts, or, I mean, I don't think he's going to go Elder Parasite. That would be a bit greedy.
No.
So, I mean, I think he's going to sit on that and maybe build into something like a Firebrand Geometer. Spain right now is pretty good versus Prisoner and Dark Lady for that matter. Mm-hmm. So I think he's going to go straight into a Geobane right now.
Yeah. All right, well, keep an eye on what Casey decides to go, but having that Rune Cleaver, so now the farming's going to start excelling. Already having the Rune Cleaver for a while is, of course, the Dark Lady, and she actually gets a Quick Blade delivered, so going to be following up with the Firebrand here. Choosing to surpass the Abyssal Skull, actually. I feel like we usually see that, at the very least, to follow a Rune Cleaver, but Formless passing it up here. You think that's going to be a bad decision in the end? As they're smoked up right here. They're looking, but...
I mean, Firebrand is always a necessity on Dark Lady. If you don't have that, I mean, you basically have no kill potential. Well, you do, but it's just like that Firebrand kind of makes that little last thing you need in your inventory slots. I mean, that extra movement speed really does a lot for chasing your opponents, and it's also better for farming. If you go straight into Firebrand after Rune Cleaver, that's going to grant you more GPM than going straight into Abyssal.
Okay. Well, if a team fight breaks out here, I mean, again, you see X-Sync, they're really moving around. They're constantly doing what they've been doing, and it's worked out so far, but a couple of times now, when the last time where it turned on them and now they come up short, they're spending a lot of time, really, trying to make this happen, ultimately to not get much out of it. I mean, I guess it is forcing the Hellborn team to play pretty defensive, to be fair, so, you know, I guess it's accomplishing something in that sense. As a Luna, by the way, uh-oh, she's being chased back. Probably going to be caught right here. But Prisoner comes in, gets hooked on a Mage Bane. Prisoner Break is out. They want to pick a fight right here. I don't know if they have the numbers, actually. The Arcane Vortex coming out. You see Dark Liddy. She is nearby. She used the Cover of Darkness, but she's just running. So Complexity actually figuring that it's not best to fight this. And they completely spread out. And everyone survives, actually. So that's the good thing. They get
only
out of there.
Only the supports getting picked. No, only the Aluna getting picked off, actually. So, I mean, that looked like this was going to be way more kills, but I guess not.
Yeah.
So Behemoth has that portal key now, though. So look for him to make some good shockwaves right now.
Yep. Yeah, he didn't use it the last fight, so he still has that good to go. But Element of Void also good to go. And I think that's probably the main reason why Complexity decided to retreat there. I think Tempest was not there, and they realized that basically everyone was of X-Sync, so did not want to go for a fight. Prisoner, meanwhile, middle lane gets the hook sidestep there, so well played by Zlapt. Sees it coming. Okay, KZ does actually just finish the Helm of the Black Legion again on top of the Ring Cleaver, so he's just going to make use of it that way.
Yeah, that's definitely better for the moment right now, but I think as the game passes on, he's going to want to settle that. At least the life to split it into heart later. So, I mean, right now it's going to benefit him, but if you give this game another 30 minutes, I mean, he's going to have to lose out on some gold there.
Yeah. But
I think that's the right call in the end, because you always want to build items that will help you, like, right now. It's kind of greedy to build towards the late game immediately. See some players, like Sibbe, sometimes going for, you know, first item post-haste. I think that's kind of greedy, but, you know.
Yeah, oh, it pulls in. He pops a shockwave, actually. Tarklin in the background jumping in, but she's dropping so quickly. She underestimated the damage completely right there. It's a one-for-one exchange. She has a buyback. I don't know if she's going to go for it, though. Prisoner, in the meantime, lock down the element. Double one catches the level, though. The buyback coming out from Tarklin. The prison break on top, and here comes Tarklin cleaning up. One goes down, two goes down, three goes down to Mage Bane, and they're looking for more still. Ophelia's in trouble. She's going to get picked off, and will it actually be a genocide to finish it all? Very possibly here. Not much Moira can do. Going for the turn kill. That ain't going to happen, though. Hat trick for Formless. That was huge for Complexity there. The Element of Void, the biggest part of it, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. You talk about good combinations with Tempest. Dark Lady with the Rune Cleaver is arguably like the best like damage assistant for the Tempest. So you saw right there, you got a three-man hold. Dark Lady charged in and basically killed everyone instantly. So
yeah.
They're going to go Kongor now, though. They don't have a life steal, as far as I know, so they might lose on a lot of health there.
Yeah, that goes back to earlier, just finishing on the Ring of the Teacher. There we go.
Oh, you got it now, yeah. Okay. So it's all coming at a nice timing right here. Winning a teamfight, transitioning to Kongor, and then maybe going to look to farm some more if they're confident in that, or just push some towers.
Yeah. Man, that fight started poorly for Complexity, too. Darkly basically suicided in right there to start the fight, and it was looking like X-Sync had a great shot, but then the ultis came together. The buyback decision, of course, was a very smart one at that, and then we saw the final result with X-Sync, or excuse me, Complexity coming out on top as the ultimates came together. Meanwhile, top lane, Aluna using that Deja Vu right here to run away, and she is going to be successful with that, so... Again, X-Sync really continuing to trying to be active, which they really should be. I mean, that is their makeup, their team here. But Complexity is playing it pretty smart. And for the most part, it seems like they are able to get away and prevent from getting jumped here. So to their benefit.
X-Sync is really trying to put out some aggression right here, but Complexity is playing so passive. Like, two of them are in the base, and now Mirax is kind of peeking out a little bit, but... They're going to find the ward here. That's a really good counter ward. That's great heads up right there from Complexity.
Yeah. Managed to see that.
Yeah.
That's in range. I felt like, God, that must have just been barely in range of that ref ward. Meanwhile, middle lane, Insania, well, yeah, just gets found and picked off here. So they have the token on Dark Liddy. If you're Complexity here, you're probably, you want to use that to push towers, right? I mean, you want to group up, I would assume, and...
I mean, they could, but I don't think they need to, because as I like, they have nothing to fear. It's only when the game hits long enough, or when Mage Bane is six slotted, that they should be like a bit threatened. I mean, all the game until then should be theirs. So, I mean, they could push, but I don't think. I mean, I don't think it's a smart decision.
Dark Lady just melted right there. That combination of Mortification and Behemoth jumping in, absolutely insane. But here's the follow-up now. Arcane Vortex already used. Dark Hoodie still taking some good damage. Needs to be careful with that. Mage Bane, by the way, locked down by Moraxis. And Dark Hoodie goes back in. And look at Mage Bane drop all of a sudden. The Dark Blades are real. And down goes Revenant as well. So another case of X-Sync. They get the jump. They get a kill initially, only for it to completely backfire in the end. Essentially a genocide. Mage Bane buys back to prevent it technically. But really not a big deal. That buyback absolutely doing nothing in the end. And they're just going to easily push in the secondary tower. But man, it's just back-to-back fights now where they just kind of reset and make it work.
Well, I mean, it was really good jump from X-Sync to start it off. They killed Darkly so fast. And their plan was probably to just back off immediately as the kill happened. But then you saw Great Hook coming in from Fuzzy Sloth, forcing a fight, forcing them to stay, and then it snowballed into genocide from them and a buyback from Mage Bane. So
yeah, that was Dark Lady baiting again. This time having the token makes it work a little better. But yeah, they do show their damage though. I mean, that was impressive.
Yeah, I mean,
she dropped.
Dark Lady couldn't even react with anything. Even if she had a shrunken head, that would have not made any difference. So
yeah. But they need a lot more time for the Mage Bane to be a huge threat also. That's the other thing here that we're definitely seeing.
Lane. Mage Bane might die.
Well, Dark Lady, did she actually not see him, or they just simply didn't think?
I think he saw him, just that he maybe expected backup. So
okay.
It's always more safe to not go, but if he saw what we saw, he would have gotten a kill right there.
Yeah. Yeah, and, you know, especially without the shrunken head, let alone Geometer's Bane, I mean, now Dark Lady is so powerful against that Mage Bane. By the way, they catch Dark Lady right here. Nice hook, though, on Amoria, trying to pull him away, but Dark Lady went in, actually, still got stunned. And she's being heavily damaged, eventually killed, most likely. Wow, she's actually going to survive. What a prison break right there from Prisoner. Or no, that's something. Anyways, Elemental Void comes out. He does get stunned shortly after, though. It's not the biggest deal right there. Mage Bane, he is still around hanging out. Moraxis, a big stun in the background, though, takes out Behemoth, as well as more of the pull onto Ophelia. She's most likely going to fall as well with the prison break. Yep, she goes down. Darkity standing her ground, takes out Mage Bane, and now it's just Revenant. Another genocide. X-Sync is so far behind now because of what just happened right there. They tried it. They're just so insistent on trying to get this Dark Lady, and every single time now it's just backfired for them.
Yeah. I mean, that's the power of Dark Lady versus Mage Bane. Dark Lady is so scary if you're playing Mage Bane. You kind of need that Geometry's Bane to deal with her so you can get out of the silence and blink away in those dangerous situations. Like, the last two fights I've seen Mage Bane die due to not having that Geo's Bane. So I think they could have been a bit more patient this game and wait for that until they really try to force things as they're doing. So
yeah,
that's unfortunate.
Yeah, it really feels like, again, it made sense early on, but this roam mentality, they kept trying to really force the issue. And with Complexity playing so defensive, as you were even pointing out, like, people were sitting in the base even. I mean, they knew that that was the case. They were playing so defensive. That really forced, you know, that didn't force them, but X-Sync figured, you know what, well, we want to make this work, so we're just going to go a little deeper than maybe we should. And trying to do so, and that was just another case of that right there. So, at the same time, though, I mean, Complexity has just been playing it smart, and they've been obviously responding very well themselves. As more kills continue, apparently, they pick off Insania over here, and then get away shortly after. So, meanwhile, bottom push happening. X-Sync has to deal with this.
Yeah, I mean, this is their last shot. If they don't do anything good from this, I think they're going to lose the game.
And rotating over, Revenant gets caught. And he goes down in the end, and he does not have a buyback. And Revenant's a big source of their damage right now.
Yeah, indeed. I don't think they're going to be able to defend this. There's no like pattern they can get in and do damage without them losing out on a lot of heroes really quickly. So they're going to let it go.
Yeah. They say one's good for now. Still keeps them somewhat okay there. They have a shot, according to them at least, but they are really far behind now.
24k gold and 30k experience. I mean, it's going to take a lot for them to come back into this game.
Yeah. They need
And they were doing pretty good early, I must say, but I mean, they dropped it as well when they teamfighted. in the top jungle, you remember when Meraxes picked up his portal key? I think that was the turning point for them.
Yeah. Yeah, coming out of that pause, exactly. That yeah. And maybe whether it's an individual choice or the team choice to try to make things happen, Magebane trying to be involved a bit earlier on in this game. And I think that, obviously, in hindsight now, that's definitely proved to be the wrong decision. If he was just simply flash farming this whole time while his team was aware of that and instead they were just keeping the other guys busy, not necessarily really picking fights, then, I mean, we would have a Magebane right now that you figure would be 600-plus GPM at least, and, you know, the game could be completely different. So,
yeah. He did go the Helm, though, so it's kind of hard. But he was still, despite building the Helm, keeping up with Dark Lady, they were almost identical GPM. So, yeah. I mean, just imagine if he did rush that Cleaver. So, I'm not saying that would be the right decision, but I'm just saying, what if?
Exactly. As meanwhile, Meraxes gets picked off, but... Well, at what cost here? Moira's going to go down. There's the Element of Void coming out of the Arcane Vortex, and both Behemoth and Revenant fall. Hat trick for Formless, actually, picks it all up. He buys a Dancing Blade with that, so we're going to be seeing that Wingbow going to be coming out for him. They're going to find Magebane here as well. Yeah, you see GGs are being called. It's just simply too much happening in favor of Complexity. So well played from Complexity right here. Definitely a very impressive performance yet again, and continuing some good momentum themselves. They defeated Evil Corporation yesterday, of course. A tough task, but took them out 2-1. That's how they got here, and now matched up against X-Sync. So are you still with us, Calamine? Any final thoughts
here?
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
Okay.
I think Complexity just took the right fights when they needed to. I mean, obviously when Meraxes got that portal key, that was really good timing.